welcome to all on this bright with snow Sunday, January morning. We gather together with gratitude for being able to gather together, gratitude for a couple of sunny days earlier this week. We also give gratitude that the light of Christ shines and is revealed even when gray or darkness descends in our physical environment or in our spiritual life. Please join with me in our Epiphany call to worship, printed in your order or shown on the screen. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. You shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill, rejoice, and proclaim the praise of the Lord. The mystery of Christ has been revealed by the Spirit. We have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise of Christ through the gospel. We know this through faith in Christ. May our light shine. Together we carry the light. I invite you to turn to number 275 in Voices Together as we sing O Beautiful Star of Bethlehem, and please stand in body or spirit.
Oh, Please stay standing and turn back one page to 274. See whose glory fills the skies. We'll sing verses 1 and 4.
Enter now into our regular time of corporate prayer for our faith family, our loved ones and friends, our community and the world. When I offer the words loving God, I invite you to respond, bring your light. Please join me in prayer. O God, you grant justice to your people who cry to you day and night. So we pray always and do not lose heart. God of glory, the light of your love cannot be overcome by darkness. Thank you for coming to the world in the flesh to breathe and walk among us and offer us abundant life. Loving God, bring your light. You fill our lives with the fruit of your light through Christ. Your steadfast love never ceases. We pray for our family of faith and our neighbors. We give thanks for the children and youth of our congregation. As these children and youth and college students begin a new season of learning, strengthen and encourage them. For teachers, staff, and administrators, give strength, wisdom, and compassion. We ask you also to prepare the hearts, minds, and bodies of some of the youth of our congregation and their leaders, as they will attend winter youth retreat this coming weekend. Loving God, bring your light. We lift to you Max Mertz as he recovers from extensive back surgery. And we remember others recovering from surgery or from injury. And as we navigate another cold and flu season and COVID is still very much a part of our lives, we pray for healing, for strengthened immune systems, and access to good care. We pray for those who are especially vulnerable to be protected. Loving God, bring your light. God, you take notice of your people. You are close to the brokenhearted. You hear our cries and see our tears. We pray for all those who grieve, remembering in a special way the fresh grief of Aura Troyer's family. Enfold this family. Enfold many others who grieve in your steadfast care. Loving God, bring your light. Your glory, O God, will appear over the nations. We pray for the world, this hurting world and this wonderful world. We give gratitude for the beauty and wonder of your creation, including the best of humanity, while alongside praying for those who are ensnared in greed, violence, and oppression, and those who are sometimes experiencing the worst of humanity. We continue our prayers for those who are suffering in the wars in Israel-Palestine, Russia, and Ukraine, while not forgetting other pockets of the world that are entangled in conflict and violence. We pray for peace and wisdom to prevail in all these situations. Loving God, bring your light. You are the God of abundant light. Your presence illumines even our darkest shadows. Gather today's sorrow as well as today's joy and remake them into generous hope, tested faith, and deep joy, that our lives may be radiant with your love and the example of Jesus. We pray in Jesus' holy and healing name. Amen. I invite you to turn to number 260 in Voices Together on this great day of days. Children and families, you're invited to come forward as we sing verses 1 and 2, and we'll sing verses 3 and 4 following children's time.
Thank you.
How does it taste?
Is that good stuff? We have a little bit more if any of you want to come try some rosca de reyes. It's a traditional Mexican bread that is usually eaten at Epiphany, or Three Kings Day. And that's what we're celebrating today. The story of Epiphany is our story today. Do you know what the story of Epiphany is? It's a big word. It means kind of a realization. And it's the story of when Jesus got some special visitors. Any idea? Yeah?
Magi.
The Magi. Yes, today's story is the story of the visit of the Magi. Do you know this story? Do you remember this one? Yeah? So what happened? Yes, the Magi came to Jesus and brought him gifts. And did they come from next door?
No,
where'd they come from?
They come from somewhere very far away.
From somewhere very far away. Yes, we have all kinds of speculations about where that was. Yeah.
They came from the east.
From the east, yeah, they were east of where Jesus was born, so east of Bethlehem. Yeah. Scholars have some differing opinions on where exactly they came from. And there is so much in this story that is so interesting. I love this story. And every year in children's time, I have to figure out what in the world to focus on because I kind of want to talk about everything. This year, we are going to talk about traveling because they came from a long way away. They had a big old journey. They were travelers. Now, we just had a couple weeks off of school. Did any of your families travel?
Yeah.
Quite a few. So, not all, but quite a few. Did any of you travel over the last month or so? Seen some nods and hands, yeah. When my family went on a trip, we got in the car and traveled a long way because we wanted to see our family who lived. One side lives 10 hours away and the other side lives 13 hours away. We knew exactly who we were going to see. We had pictures of them. We knew why we were traveling. And I wonder, how much did the Magi know about who they were traveling to see? Not a lot, right? The scripture says that they knew they were coming to visit a king who had been born. But I wonder, what do you think they thought that king would be like? Now, when my family went on a trip, we packed warm clothes and things to entertain us while we traveled, and a little bit of food for our journey. We packed presents to take to the people that we were visiting. Do you think any of those things were similar to what the Magi would have packed? No and yes. So some were the same and some were different, right?
Presents for Jesus,
probably some food. Yeah, I wonder, did they pack all their food or did they find food along the way?
Both,
you think?
Yeah, both.
Yeah, there's so much we don't know, but we have some thoughts. And I wonder how they entertained themselves. Did they tell stories and sing songs, maybe? We've got a maybe, yeah. Maybe they told jokes. Okay, if any of you can think of some good Magi jokes, please tell them to me. I would love some Magi traveling jokes. You can tell me after worship, okay? Otherwise, this is gonna turn into a big old joke fest, which is not a terrible idea. We'll do that sometime. Now, when my family took our trip, we knew where we were going for a couple of reasons. We had traveled that journey many times before, and Daniel turned on his GPS. And so we could use that to avoid road closures and to make sure that we didn't accidentally miss an exit. We were pretty confident that we would not get lost. In fact, we have never gotten lost making that journey. But I wonder about the Magi. As far as we know, they had never made this trip before. And did they have GPS?
No.
Did most of you have GPS when you were these kids' age?
No.
What did they have? Maps? A sky map. The stars were their GPS. Thank you, Ryan. Yes. So God created the world with a giant map in the sky. And turn right at the North Star. That's right, in a GPS voice. Maybe that's how they found their way. Actually, not even maybe. We know that's how they found their way. So it takes some work to know how to read that map in the sky, but these magi knew how to do it. I think it's pretty cool that the entire cosmos helped the magi find their way to baby Jesus. It's fun to imagine this stuff. Today's the last day of the Christmas season. Did you know that? Did you know the Christmas season actually begins on Christmas Day? And goes until now? Yeah, so today's the end. Sadly. Eliana would be up for this lasting always and forever. Today we remember that Jesus was revealed to the whole world, to the whole cosmos, the earth, the universe, and that includes us right here and right now. Today we eat sweet bread, and we remember that just like God called those magi to seek Jesus, to search for him, God calls us to search for Jesus. We are all travelers. I pray that each of you all, seek Jesus always. You may head back to your seats while we sing, and if you want to take another piece, you may. Long ago, God spoke through the cosmos to bring good news to the world. Today we have heard and we have sung the story of the visit of the Magi, Epiphany, revelation of God's incarnation, the Messiah King who caused a star to be born turns out to be a tiny, demanding, helpless baby. It's a beautiful story. One of my favorite moments from this year's Christmas pageant was watching the large company of magi process down the aisle and then reverently take a knee and offer shining gifts to the baby. But there is a shadow story that is woven throughout this story of sparkling knights and travelers and worship. It's a story of prophecies and dreams and politics and manipulation and violence, and we're often not sure what to do with it. Sometimes we avoid it, sometimes we take a deep dive into it. Some of you may want me to avoid it today, and I get that, but I'm not going to. So, take a deep breath, and we'll begin by reading the text in an interpretation that is new to most of us. Sometimes doing that helps us to hear things in new ways. This one comes from the First Nations Version, an Indigenous translation of the New Testament. This was developed by a community, and that community followed the Native people's tradition of naming. So some of the names will seem a little different. They're mostly whatever the name actually means is what they are called. And you'll see them as we normally read them on the screen as well. So Matthew 2, 13 through 23. The seekers of wisdom were warned in a dream not to go back to Looks Brave. So they returned to their homeland by a different road. After the seekers of wisdom had gone, a spirit messenger from Creator warned he gives sons in a dream. "Rise up," he said urgently. "Take the child and his mother and go quickly to Blackland and remain there until I tell you to leave. Looks Brave is searching for the child to kill him." That night, he gives sons took the child and his mother, and they fled for their lives to Blackland. They remained there until the death of Looks Brave. This gave full meaning to Creator's ancient prophecy: "I will call my son out from Blackland." When Looks Brave realized he had been outsmarted by the seekers of wisdom, he was full of rage. Using the knowledge he had gained from them, he gave orders for all male children in House of Bread under 2 winters of age to be put to death. This gave full meaning to another ancient prophecy spoken by Lifted by Creator. "A sound of weeping and wailing is heard in Highland. Sheep woman is shedding tears for her children. No one can bring her peace, because her children have been taken from the land of the living." After Looks Brave died, a spirit messenger from Creator appeared again to He Gives Sons in a dream while he was still in Blackland. The spirit messenger said to him, "Get up and take the child and his mother back to the land of the tribes of wrestles with Creator, for the ones who were trying to take the child's life are dead." He Gives Sons got up, took the child and his mother, and began to go where he was told. On the way, when he heard that Rules the People, the son of Chief Looks Brave, had become the new chief, he became afraid. After being warned in another dream, he took a different path to their home through Circle of Nations, to an out-of-the-way village most people looked down on called Seed Planter Village. This gave full meaning to the words of the prophets: "He will be called a seed planter." The word of the Lord. Sounds a little different, doesn't it? There are all kinds of debates about the historicity of this story. Did it really happen? That is not going to be our concern today. It's interesting, but we'll focus on something a little different. Instead, we're going to ask the question, how might this text be speaking to us in our current context? How is this a prophetic text in a hurting world? Let's take a look at these characters. Our story begins in the time of Herod the Great, or Looks Brave, as today's translation cleverly names him. The Herod is a position. Herod is not a first name. And the Herod was what history now calls a Roman Jewish client king. This particular Herod had a Jewish grandmother and was raised with Jewish customs, but he was from a political family that was closely aligned with the Roman Empire. And the Roman Empire was the occupying force in this time. It occupied much of the known world and was, by all accounts, oppressive. So who was the Herod? Was the Herod Jewish? Kind of. He observed some customs. He had some ancestry. But I think what's key here is his loyalty. His loyalty was to Rome. And ultimately, his loyalty seems to have been to his own personal power. We know that this particular Herod was easily threatened. Looks brave, maybe only looked brave. He ordered assassinations of anyone who threatened his power. We know this from historical documents. And in today's story, we see that even toddlers were not immune to his jealousy. So we have the Herod, a complicated character. And then we have an entire people, those who were living in this particular region under the Roman Empire, many of whom were ethnically Jewish, and because of that identity, had the trauma of other occupations and exiles in their DNA. And then in this group of people, we specifically have this little family, Joseph and Mary, although she's not named in this particular text, and their newborn son, Jesus. Mary and Joseph, ordinary members of the Jewish community, raising an extraordinary child. A humble little family, an occupied people with a complex history, and a powerful man who represented a powerful empire. And because that powerful man felt threatened, an entire group of people was oppressed. I know that we sometimes want to keep politics out of the Bible, but it's unavoidable. Politics is written in, woven into this origin story of Jesus. Now, this is not the first time that innocent children were ordered to be killed because a ruler felt threatened. What does this story remind us of? Not rhetorical. Moses, Pharaoh, yes, thank you. Yeah, the time of Moses when all baby boys were ordered to be killed. And it wouldn't be the last time that innocent people would bear the brunt of threatened rulers' insecurities. We can't hear this story today and not think about all of the occasions throughout history when a people group has been oppressed because of political insecurities. We can't hear it today and not think about Ukraine coming up on 2 years since the Russian invasion with no end in sight. We can't hear this story today and not think about the many innocent people in Israel, specifically in Gaza, who are losing their lives and homes in the name of centralized power, while the world looks on in approval. This story was not the first time and wouldn't be the last. And in the midst of all of this, God entered the story. God spoke to Joseph as God had spoken to his ancestor Joseph in a dream. And he gives sons. Joseph took his son by adoption, and his wife, and fled to Egypt. And again, it's not the first time that Egypt has been a place of refuge when lives are in danger. Abraham, Joseph of the coat of many colors, the prophet Jeremiah, they all took refuge in Egypt earlier in this story. And again, it wouldn't be the last time that people would flee to Egypt for refuge. As we worship this morning, there are people fleeing for their lives and attempting to enter Egypt. The story was not the first time, and it wouldn't be the last. As a young child, Jesus became a refugee. This is a story that we must remember. This is a prophetic text in a hurting world. In a world that tries to stop immigration or that sees the refugee as the problem, we cannot forget that the Holy Family were refugees. To you who have been refugees, hear this. Jesus gets it. Jesus knows what it's like to be you. Emmanuel, God with us, has also been a stranger in a foreign land. He has traveled dangerous journeys and fled for his life. Jesus has traveled the same road. And to others of us, what do we do with this? How do we read this story and take it seriously in our context? I'm going to admit that I have been feeling a little angry since October. I am angered by one-dimensional narratives from people of all perspectives. I'm angered by mainstream Christianity siding with oppression in the name of Jesus. I'm angered by false narratives. I'm angry that my tax dollars are being used all over the world to perpetuate violence. I'm angry that this is so complicated and that I don't get it. Probably most of all, I'm angry at myself for not knowing what to do about it all and sometimes simply freezing and doing nothing. I don't know what to say. I don't know how to sort out all of these complexities. As I prepared this sermon, I prayed, God, my heart is so heavy, and I don't know what I can say. And God's earth supported me, and God's breath kept going through me like it always does. And I think God was nudging me to just be honest. So, here we are. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. I have no answers this morning. But we tell the story, and we ask the story to speak to us. We tell the story of travelers who saw a cosmological sign that the world was changing for good. We tell the story of worship that permeated borders and peoples. We tell the story of God who speaks and who enters the story. We tell the story of human greed that perpetuates violence. We tell the story of innocent lives being lost. We tell the story of Jesus, the refugee king. Of parents who make the excruciating choice to travel with their young child to a foreign place. And all of that matters. Knowing this story must make a difference in how we interact with the world. It must make a difference in our actions right here in our context, in our words right here in our context. This is a prophetic text in a hurting world. I don't know where that leads. We've established I don't know what to do, but let's open the conversation. We still have slips of papers in your pews. We still have a manger here for one last Sunday. Write your thoughts, your questions, your wonderings, and during the offering, you can bring those up and put them in this symbol of the Christ child. I also prayed for words of comfort to say to you this morning. Preaching is supposed to be about sharing the good news. I would like a little good news to share. And one of the things that jumped out to me was the phrase, God entered the story. God entered the story in incarnation, in the baby Christ. God entered the story in dreams. God entered the story in places of refuge, in travel, in people. We know God entered the story in ways that are not even told to us in this scripture. And God enters the story today. God always enters the story. And so we together ask God to enter the story right here and right now. And we have boldness to ask that because it has happened over and over throughout history. This is not the first time, and it won't be the last. As we seek Jesus, like those magi long, long ago, Jesus is right there beside us on that journey. God was, God is, God will be. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Talasha. As we tell the story, we also sing the story in your, not in the Sing the Story hymnal right now, but in Voices Together, we'll sing part of this story again in hymn number 279, Jesus Entered Egypt.
Now to our time of giving our gifts and offerings. And today is our birthday offering. So if you have a birthday in the month of January, please come forward for a blessing. We will be singing the song Longing for Light, number 715, as our offering song. And Anne-Marie will let us know what verses we'll be singing.
15, we'll sing verses 1, 2, 3, and 5.
You are my Savior, Lord, and Savior.
Join me in prayer. God of our lives, thank you for all of these gifts given with all of the labor that goes behind them and all of the joy and all of the journey, just as those gifts were presented to Jesus long, long ago. I pray that you will give us wisdom to seek you always and to use these gifts to be your kingdom here on earth. I pray too that you will continue to walk with us and guide us, giving us wisdom for the journey, lighting our paths, and walking with us. God with us, we are grateful for this chance to see you and to know you. Your love made real, made human, incarnate. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing now Solemn Stillness, Weary Streets, number 276. Talk about hope. This song gives that to me. We are wonders, blessed wonders, bringing joy to the world. Stand as we sing, if you are able.
Just a couple of announcements before our benediction. We are back to Sunday school today after a holiday hiatus because of lots of other things going on in our church life. Also, next weekend is MLK weekend, and we welcome Sunitha Millsaps as our preacher, and she'll also be sharing in the Sunday school hour. receive these words of benediction. Go now, remembering how God always enters the story. Go now, looking for how God enters the story. Go in peace.